Dentro de algunos meses en la colección de Historia del Fondo vamos a publicar el libro Las Brujas de Stacy Shipp. Este es un libro que realmente refleja un horror que es, sabemos, pero que realmente no conocemos a fondo, que es el pánico moral que vivieron las ciudades de Massachusetts en el siglo XVII, ¿no? Entonces, esta investigación, hay un contexto muy grande en el que la autora, con un estilo perspicaz, intrigante, casi a modo de novela, nos va retratando pues todas las aristas que tenían que ver con estas mujeres que de alguna manera eran extraordinarias, pero no eran aceptadas en su tiempo y fueron condenadas por brujería, ¿no? Nuestra autora Stacy Shipp, ella nació en Adams, que está en Massachusetts, ha escrito ensayos y artículos publicados por el New York Times y The New Yorker, y además fue ganadora del premio Pulitzer en el año 2000 por su biografía de Vera Nabokova. Y además, pues tiene otros libros como el de Cleopatra, que también vamos a publicar en la colección de Historia del Fondo de Cultura Económica. Y estamos muy contentos, Paco Taibo y yo, de estar aquí conversando con Stacy. Hello, Stacy. Thanks for connecting with us.
Thank you for doing this.
Stacy, it's clear that you are an excellent researcher. The information, the way you put together the story, but you are an excellent writer.
Thank you.
How do you survive the academic structure of the United States and became such a good writer? Because the story is great. The story is great. And the research is very precise. Full of information, contextual information, but it can be read perfectly as a novel.
You know, the difficult thing with this book and the reason I wanted to write about Salem is that we don't really have a read, we didn't have a readable narrative history that made these people feel real to us, that made them feel as if they were living, breathing human beings with loves and antipathies and grudges and taste in food. They were all cardboard figures. So when I started, what I was really focusing on was, first of all, explaining how this delusion could take off, how this many people could be caught up in this kind of craziness, but also in fleshing out the characters. It was really important to me that you understood the ministers, that you understood the justices, that you understood why a woman would walk into court and say, you know, this spectral cat assaulted me, which doesn't happen every day of the week.
When I read the book, I'm also a fan of something that you can call narrative history. The way that a good story is there, but you have to tell them. Sometimes in the universities, they teach you to research, but they don't teach you to write what you research. And the main purpose of history is put together and put in the hands of the people. And the story is the story of the people is afraid of women, no? In every society. But in this story that you put together, the frightened killers are so huge, so horrible, that they put you to go deeper, not only in the story that you put together, but also in the story of why people is afraid of women.
And that is one of the difficulties in writing about something that has this many dimensions to it, in that you want the reader to feel some suspense. You don't want to know, as you would with an academic book, just at the outset, here's what happened and here's why it happened. You want to build toward the reasoning behind the insanity. So holding off on some of the larger issues until the end of the book was, to me, I mean, it's a closed room mystery, is really what it is, right? You have these tiny communities cut off from the rest of the world, and they engage in this seemingly inexplicable behavior. So why? Why so many accusations and why so much prosecution? And the answers for that, I thought, had to wait until the end of the book, which, of course, in an academic book, they could not. That's one answer to your question. And the other is, yes, the fear of women is rampant, and you can see it in the court testimony. So much of that testimony is based on men having remembered too vividly a woman whom they had seen the previous day in church, or having had an earlier encounter with a woman who somehow terrified them and they had no means of expressing the terror. But it's also women being afraid of women, interestingly
Yes.
enough. And it goes across the board. I mean, that's what's it's not, you know, the typical, oh, this were older women. Young women are accused, men are accused, minister is accused. It, the entire delusion takes off into all kind, into every corner of Massachusetts life.
Do you think that throughout the history it is possible to vindicate characters that have not had the relevance they deserve?
I think it is possible to put them back in their place and also to show the involvement of certain people behind the scenes, because there's a lot of manipulating the events that goes on here. So for example, the minister who plays the largest behind the scenes role, who advises everyone else, and who's in many ways responsible for planting the ideas in people's heads in the first place, he afterward will say, well, really no big deal. No people of great worth were lost. The church got filled the pews and the devil got nothing. And he'll justify the entire, he won't say, well, 19 people hanged. I mean, he won't say, well, we sacrificed innocents. So fleshing people out like that and fleshing out what their agendas were was really, is really, I think, possible even at this distance.
What would you say about your books to the Spanish-speaking public?
I'm delighted that you think the narrative, that they read like narrative, Paco. I mean, that's really what you spend all your time trying to do, right? Trying to make it feel, trying to engage the reader, trying to make the reader turn the next page. And to think that they do that in the first place is one thing, but to know, to suspect or to hope they do that in another language is even more rewarding. I mean, it's that's always the struggle, especially with something that's older history, right? Making these people feel palpable and true to us, and also engaging the reader with concepts that are no longer entirely familiar to us.
Your book is a machete, mi querida Stacy. Wow. It's a machete. It deals with three things. The first two we have talked about, narrative history and why they are afraid of women. But the third one is as important as the other two. It's fundamentalismo religioso. Yeah? You follow the Spanish, right? Fundamentalismo religioso, which is one of the evils of the 21st century.
Yeah, and so much here is based on a fundamental belief in the truth of the Bible. In other words, there are many reasons to believe in witchcraft. I think almost every culture has a belief in, of some kind in witchcraft. I think a lot of us would like to believe in witchcraft the same way we like to believe in astrologers and fortune tellers and other things. But in 17th century Massachusetts, you believed in witchcraft because the Bible told you to. And if it weren't for those lines in the Bible that say things like, thou shalt not suffer a witch to live, which implies that a witch must exist in the first place, none of this would have happened. So there is this sense of going back to the original texts and taking those and applying them in a disproportionate way or in an inaccurate way to the events at hand. And again, it is, as I said, it's being driven by these ministers who had been driving Massachusetts already for decades and hope very much to continue to do so, and who feel their influence falling off a little bit, which is one of the strains that the trials will reveal, and who very much want, whom everyone goes to for advice, and who very much want still to be steering the train here.
This society has to put in front of them. You can kill in the name of the Bible, you can kill in the name of the Quran, you can kill in any names, but be careful, because you are killing something, you are killing yourself. It's a very important book, Stacy. It's going to be a success in Mexico. I swear it. Soon as we discover that you have a Cleopatra in your hands, we bought it without reading it.
Oh, you should probably.
We never do that.
I hope you won't be disappointed. But you know, but that's one of the things that's really, that we, I think we overlook with Salem, with the witches, is that you thought you were doing your religious duty. You thought you were being pious by accusing your neighbor because you thought that was what the church was encouraging you to do. And that is one of the reasons why the contagion, why you have this contagion of accusations, why you have people pointing fingers left and right, because they feel they're doing their godly duty and turning in their mothers, brothers, sisters, grandmothers, whatever. And that is, down that road goes, is utter craziness.
Jean-Paul Sartre said, there are no others. We are the others. Yeah? And this reflection is essential for a publishing house.
And to any kind of freedom of speech, right? I mean, a lot of what goes on here is just a tamped down frustration that can't be vented. And it gets vented in this very distorted, damaging way. Partly because, I mean, even with the girls, the young girls themselves, the original girls clearly suffer from something. We'll never know what it was, but they suffer from something, which sounds to us like hysteria. But they didn't have the words for it, and they didn't have the freedom to express it. And that, as we all know from modern examples, tends to express itself physically. It comes out in the contortions and the grimaces and the paralysis and the trances that they demonstrate. And there's just a case where if you had the freedom to speak your mind, if there had been someone who was willing to listen to these young women, none of this would have necessarily taken off with the velocity anyway that it did.
Stacy, welcome home.
Thank you. I look forward to seeing you in person.
Thank you so much, Stacy.
I already loved Mexico, but now I do more. Thank you both for your loveliness and your enthusiasm.